Hey guys, welcome back to Uncanny Channel. Today we're going to be talking about Bill Ramsey, the Southend Werewolf. Bill Ramsey was raised in the seaside town of Southend, Essex in the UK, and he was a largely normal child. He was a normal kid with a normal kid's interests, a healthy imagination. It wasn't until he was 9 years old that things started getting weird. The most significant event of his childhood happened on a warm summer day in 1952 when he was playing in the backyard and suddenly felt this like icy chill wash over his entire body, even though it was a hot day out. And even though he was feeling this icy chill, he was sweating profusely and he started smelling the strong odor of rotting meat. So he's freaking out and he calls his mom to come help him. And she rushes in the backyard along with his father, who also overheard the commotion. And they come into the backyard just in time to see him uproot a concrete fence post. This 9-year-old kid uproot a concrete fence post and smash it on the ground and rip out the mesh fencing and start chewing on it and growling. And his parents were just so terrified of what he was doing and what he might do that they hid in the house until the episode was over. So I mean, you know, judge them how you want. Ramsey claimed that during this incident, the only things that were in his mind was this image of a pack of wolves and of ocean waves crashing on the beach. But aside from that one really bizarre incident, he didn't have any other problems throughout his childhood. He didn't have another one of these rage incidents or any other kind of abnormal childhood experiences. He grew up to be a pretty normal person. He got married and had kids and lived a pretty normal, healthy life until about 15 years after this incident when he was 9 years old. For the first 2 years of his marriage, Bill would have these really intense nightmares. And it was always the same nightmare where he was walking down this path behind his wife, and at some point she would turn around, and when she saw him, she would scream and run away. He would wake up in a cold sweat and he would feel like a deep kind of guttural growl. He described it as the same feeling he got when he was a child during his fence post incident. Eventually it got to the point that he would wake up growling uncontrollably. But nightmares eventually go away and he doesn't have another incident for another 15 years. And he's kind of optimistic that maybe this is the end of all of this, but alas, 15 years after the nightmares, it gets bad and it gets bad really quick. In 1983, not only does Ramsey go through this very intense incident, but he also realizes that his 15-year grace period between incidents is no longer existent. So in 1983, he is at a pub with some friends when he starts to get that feeling. He's like out with his friends, they're having a good time. And when he starts to get these feelings, he starts freaking out because he knows what this situation could turn into and he really does not want that. So he excuses himself to the men's room to try to get his composure, and he looks at himself in the mirror and doesn't see his own reflection, but instead sees the face of a wolf. So now he's freaking out even harder. He leaves the restroom, he goes to the table where his friends are, and he's shaking, he's sweating. His friends are like, "We gotta get him out of here." I don't know if his friends were familiar with the situation that he had as far as these outbursts, or if they just thought that he was really drunk, but he and his buddies are on the way back to his place. He's in the back seat with a couple of friends, and then there's a different friend who's driving, and he starts feeling this feeling even more intensely, and he starts growling and howling, and he attacks one of the friends who's in the back seat with him. He's sinking his teeth into this guy's leg, and they're pulling the car over and trying to pull him out of the back seat, and he's got this friend in like this vice grip, like this coquina clutch, intense kind of grip, and it takes them a long time to get him out of the car. I didn't see this in all of the sources that I used, but a couple of sources mentioned that during this whole incident, the friends reported that he started growing hair in places, that his teeth were like becoming fangs, and he had his hands had like started to transform into claws. These kind of like wolfish features started appearing all over his body. Eventually they do subdue him and get him to calm down. And obviously he has no idea what happened, but he has a suspicion of what happened because it's not like this is the first time. Towards the end of the year, so not 15 years later, but a few months later, he starts having chest pains. and he thinks that he's having a heart attack. So he takes himself to the ER to get himself checked out, and while they're doing the EKG, he attacks the nurse who's doing the EKG. He sinks his teeth into her arm, and he starts running around the ward, howling and growling and pushing people over and just going nuts in this ER ward. It ends up taking an entire team of people to bring him down because any one person who approached him to try to subdue him ended up getting knocked down or thrown across the room, almost like he had this superhuman strength. Eventually, the police had to come and tranquilize him in order to end the rampage. After this incident, obviously they kept him overnight, and when he wakes up the next day from the tranquilizer wearing off, he has no clue what happened. Witnesses claim that they saw his shoulders hunch and his hands turn to claws and his teeth become fangs during this incident. A similar situation happened a month later in January 1984 when he once again thought he was having a heart attack and went to the ER and attacked a nurse and then attacked an orderly and then essentially kind of repeated himself and went on a rampage. He was throwing people around, he was flipping furniture, growling, snarling. Basically, the whole ER staff ends up having to get involved in order to keep him contained, and by chance, four police officers enter the ER while he's there and attempt to subdue him and like put cuffs on him and everything. And it takes all four officers with all of their equipment to bring him down, calm him down, take him to the station. Not without issue, because one of the four officers was so badly injured he had to stay in the hospital for 4 days until they were sure he was safe to go home. I don't know why he wasn't booked for this, because I mean, disorderly conduct at best, attacking a police officer at worst. But they get into the station, and from what I could find, they didn't charge him with anything or put him in jail. They just kind of set him down, were like, listen man, you might want to go to a psych hospital for a few days just to make sure you're all right, you know, for safety's sake. And this is still a time when mental health was a lot more stigmatized, and he was like, nah bruh, I don't want to be labeled as a crazy person. So he just leaves and goes home. And the fact that he just leaves, I cannot believe that no action was taken by the police in this situation. But I guess they're gonna learn their lesson, because a few years later, he's coming back to the station. In 1987, Ramsey essentially puts a sex worker, maybe she's a teenager, maybe she's not, different sources, he basically puts her under citizen's arrest and puts her in his car and takes her to the police station to have them deal with it. Glass houses, bro. And while he's at the police station, he has another incident, and it's bad. It is the worst so far. It starts with him attacking one of the officers who's there to get information about why he's even here in the first place. And Ramsey attacks him and throws him on the ground and starts choking him. And obviously, when other officers get involved, he attacks them too and starts going after whoever's in his path. One of the sources described this scene as knocking officers over like matchsticks. So, there's a visual if you're a visual person. This time it allegedly took a dozen police officers and two tranquilizers to subdue him. A few sources even reported that he at some point launched himself through a cell door and they had to call the fire brigade to come like cut him out of this metal door. And obviously this time he's kept in custody. And while he's in custody, they give him all kinds of neurological tests. They throw the MRIs at him, the CAT scans. They basically do any kind of neurological test that would maybe shed some light on why this is happening, because he, once again, has no memory, which might suggest that there's some kind of brain function issue. But all of the tests come back negative or normal. They all come back normal. Finally, they do a psych evaluation, and that for the most part comes back normal too. He doesn't appear to have any other mental illnesses that are underlying or anything. And the person conducting the evaluation diagnoses him with clinical lycanthropy. So the term lycanthropy basically just means the condition of being a werewolf. And clinical lycanthropy is a extremely, extremely rare mental illness in which people believe that they are an animal. They believe that they have transformed either completely or partially into a non-human animal, like a wolf. So, obviously, the media got a hold of it. And when I say media, I don't mean like real news media, like national news. I mean like tabloids got a hold of it and started sensationalizing it, as you do. And From those tabloids is where this idea of the Southend Werewolf terminology comes from. And this diagnosis is pretty much the accepted cause of Bill Ramsey's uncontrollable rage episodes until the king and queen of controversy themselves, Ed and Lorraine Warren, get involved. If you know anything about famous hauntings whatsoever, you probably know who Ed and Lorraine Warren are, and you probably have an opinion about Ed and Lorraine Warren. I was telling my husband about this story, and he is totally a skeptic and like doesn't really like keep up with paranormal investigations or hauntings or anything like that. And when I mentioned Ed and Lorraine Warren, even he was like, ugh, Ed and Lorraine Warren. If you don't know who Ed and Lorraine Warren are, they're the paranormal investigators that investigated and popularized basically any haunted house franchise that you know of. They investigated the Amityville haunting, Annabelle the doll, the Smurl family, the Perrin family, who was the basis for The Conjuring, the Einfeld poltergeist. That's all the Warrens, and it's all controversial. So the Warrens catch wind of this guy, Bill Ramsey, the Southend Werewolf, through American media outlets and are like, "Ya boy's possessed." They reached out to him and offered to host him at their church in Connecticut to do an exorcism. And although Bill is kind of skeptical at first, which I would be too, he eventually is like, yeah, sure, fine, like, it can't make it any worse. And also, free trip to America, so cool. In 1989, Ramsey travels out to Connecticut, and him and the Warrens and Bishop Robert McKenna all convene at Our Lady of the Rosary Chapel. Bishop McKenna begins the exorcism ritual, and as the ritual goes on, Ramsey starts to feel another episode coming on. The only records that we have about what happened during the exorcism are witness accounts, a few photographs, and allegedly there is a video of it, but I wasn't able to find it anywhere, so I don't know if it actually exists or if it's just one of those things where they say, oh, and we caught it on tape too, so we have that evidence if you need it. Or if it was an actual real existing like video of the exorcism. But if you do know where to find that video, let me know, because I'm pretty curious actually about it. Anyway, the witnesses to the exorcism reported that as it went on, they saw him begin to turn. His hands started turning into claws, and his ears started becoming pointed and growing hair. His teeth started to become fangs, and he was growling and snarling and fighting and trying to attack Bishop McKenna. Eventually, he had to be restrained so that McKenna could finish the exorcism right without being attacked. McKenna was able to complete the exorcism, and he told the demon to leave this man. And Bill reports feeling one final surge of just anger and rage, and then it was gone. After the exorcism, Bill was exhausted. He was drenched in sweat. He couldn't remember anything that happened except that when the exorcism ended, he felt like something evil had left him. After the exorcism, Bill largely disappears from the public eye. But he did return briefly in the early 90s just to give an update of his progress and if anything else had happened since the exorcism. He said that he hadn't experienced another episode at all since the exorcism was completed, and he kind of just goes back to his normal life. We don't really know what happened to him after that update, but I think it's safe to assume that he didn't have any more incidents, A, because we would have heard about it, and B, because they were becoming so much more frequent, happening within months of each other as opposed to 15-year spans, that I think it's safe to say that if it was ramping up so hard and then stopped all of a sudden for 2 years, that's kind of a good indicator that that progress had stopped. So what do you guys think? I know it seems pretty cut and dry. He was possessed and then he was executed, exorcised. But I think there is a third opinion that I kind of want to bring up, because I didn't really see it mentioned a lot in the sources or in any of the areas that I saw talking about this. I think alongside the theory that he was a genuine lycanthrope, just like your like traditional werewolf, and the theory that he was demon possessed, I think that there is an important third theory which goes back to the diagnosis of clinical lycanthropy. If he had conditioned himself to anticipate these episodes, it's possible that he created this like self-fulfilling prophecy where he anticipated that they would happen and believed they would happen, and so they did in fact happen to him. And he believes the exorcism worked because he felt relief afterwards. So it's possible that whatever kind of gotten a placebo effect from that, where he had believed he would have the episodes, and so he did, and now he believed he had been cured from the episodes, so he was. I honestly don't know enough about clinical lycanthropy to state any of that as fact, so anything I say about it is just purely speculation. I think it's still possible that he was an actual werewolf or possessed, but I thought that this was a pretty viable theory that makes just as much sense as the other two theories, so I wanted to present it just because I don't really see it mentioned a lot, but I think it's a pretty logical possible explanation of what happened. So what do you guys think? Was he an actual werewolf? Was he possessed by a demon? Did he actually suffer from clinical lycanthropy and this was all like a psychological experience for him? Or do you have a different theory about Bill Ramsey and what caused him to experience these werewolf episodes? Let me know in the comments below. Hit subscribe and ring the little bell so that you get notified anytime that I post new content. Like this video, aka thumb me, if you think you know me like that. And remember that it's a wonderful thing to believe in the unbelievable. Until next time, bye guys.